Hi.
This is the AMWD College of Medicine at the University of Liberia.
Has been involved in the crisis in Liberia, trying to find and mobilize resources to provide relief and assistance to the victims of this civil disturbance. We came here last year, about a year and a half ago precisely, to develop or start a dialogue for a comprehensive mobile healthcare delivery system, which for the first time was going to be utilized here in Liberia.
From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
I'm honored and privileged to be here today. I don't think I'm worthy, but I considered it a unique pleasure and privilege to be able to talk about my mother. I loved her very much, and she was a wonderful woman. She was not only a great mother, she was mother to many people. My home in Liberia was like a mission. You know what they call a mission, right? Where people raise children. My mother raised a lot of people. She fed the hungry. She clothed the naked. She educated the ignorant. And she housed the homeless. And many times when people wonder how blessings come to me, I say, well, it's due to my mother. I miss her very much. But on her dying bed, she made me promise her. She could barely speak. She said to me, she said, promise me that you will have my autobiography published. And so when we were leaving Liberia after the coup in 1980, I couldn't bring anything with me, but I made sure that I brought her manuscripts with me.
I'm Professor Dr. Vivian Seton, and I'd like to welcome Her Excellency Mrs. Sirleaf to Washington. I'm a media consultant, and I think most Liberians know me as Pipshin, having worked for the Voice of America for many, many years. I don't have a question today. I'm a Liberian woman, and I think I express the sentiments of all Liberian women when I say, madam, we are extremely proud of you.
Yes, indeed.
And each of us, in our own little way, thought of something that we can do for you so that you can know how we feel about you. Some of us cooked a nice dinner for you as we ate at the reception. Some of us made calendars. And my little group, my colleagues and friends and relatives and collaborators, we got together and in 1 week we produced this magazine with the
Whoa.
Official photo of Mrs. Sirleaf on the cover. So I'd like to present you with a copy of it. And we wish you well, we wish you Godspeed and God's blessing as you lead that ship of state, which we know will not be a very easy task, but we know that the Lord will be with you and that you will be successful. Thank you.
Thank you.
I want to turn to Vivian here in studio. Your grandfather was a very special friend to Marcus Garvey. Briefly tell us why this is very personal to you.
Well, it's very personal to me because of my family connection to Prince Mamalu Masakoi. And also it is important to me because as a professor of history, we have studied all of these movements and I came to realize that the liberation of the black man today and the possibility for a black man to become president of the United States of America goes back to the Pan-African movement of almost 150 years ago, when many black Americans, William Du Bois, Marcus Garvey, Bishop Stokes, Bishop Rembrandt, Bishop Phillips, got together to focus the attention of the black men in America on Africa. And Prince Mamalu Massacre was a part of this movement.
And he was actually also investigated along with Marcus Garvey for a crime that they were, you know, kind of supposed to be charged with, but he was found to be not guilty of any of those charges, right?
Yes. J. Edgar Hoover said to the public and to the president at the time that that African prince is harmless. So he exonerated my grandfather. Mm-hmm. But he prosecuted Garvey. Later on, his sentence was commuted, for him to serve time in jail, but he was deported back to Jamaica, where he eventually died.
Welcome to Focus on Liberia. Our topic tonight is the Liberian woman. And to some people, this may not be an ordinary topic. So help my viewers understand the importance of this discussion tonight. And why is it so dear to you, the Liberian woman?
Well, thank you for the question. And this is a topic or subject that is very close to my heart. Of course, I hope I'm a woman. So I'm very concerned about what happens to my sisters, not only here in America, but also in Liberia and across the world. And I belong to many organizations that I created to help the woman grow economically, socially, academically, financially, and in many other spheres. I've been very interested in what happens to women. I was born to an exceptional woman, and I've always had women in high regard. I'm interested also, or very much interested, in what happens to the woman in Liberia in particular, and in Africa in general. And I've watched what takes place in the world to women. That is why I also started a magazine for women. So this is a topic that is constantly on my mind. I'm in the process of writing a book on Liberia. I've written some others, but this one pertains to the Liberian woman. I called it Lapa to Skirt, or Lapas to Skirts, because the Liberian woman originally wore lapas. But now things have progressed, transformed, and now they wear skirts. Of course, lapas, some of them still wear lapas. Some of them wear both lapas and skirts. Some of them wear pants. Some of them wear hot pants, different kinds of clothing. And some of them only wear skirts. So to cut all of this transformation short, I call the book Lapas to Skirts. And that's the history of Liberia, but from the woman's standpoint, how women influence society, the role of women in society, and the role of women for Liberia, for the future of Liberia, if Liberia is supposed to survive or come back, the women have a major role to play in that process. And so this is why I would like to look at the topic and see what we can do and how we can get our sisters, especially the young women of Liberia, involved in bringing Liberia back.
The leader of the Songhay Empire at the time was a man called Jomani, mm-hmm. Or Kamala the Great, or Kamara the Great. And because we all know that Muslims and Africans have many wives, so Jomani had many wives, and of course he had many children. Mm-hmm. So every year they would consult the oracle. And when they consulted the oracle one year, the oracle told them that if Jomani didn't send his youngest son away, that his empire would come to an end. So Jomani decided to send his son, Kamara the younger, toward the sea in search of salt, because you know that in the desert, salt is more valuable than gold, mm-hmm. because you have to sweat. So he gave Jomani the younger a large army, a large group of followers, and he asks 11 of his cousins, 11 princes, to accompany Germany toward the west. And he gave him a large army, and in those days, of course, the armies would go with their wives and children because travel was so long and difficult. So this group of people started traveling toward the Atlantic Ocean. It took a long time. They encountered many hardships. When they got to the forest, they encountered wild beasts. Some of them were killed. Some of them perished on their own because the journey took a long time and was very dangerous. So some of them decided to wait at the edge of the forest. And Germani, of course, wanted to prove to his father and his followers that he was brave. Mm-hmm. So he went through the forest. And when they got to what is called today Kweji, in other words, and that's the in Mende, Kwei means water, and Ji is salt water. So they got to a place they called salt water, and there he went into the ocean, and he led his horse into the ocean 7 times, and he said that we have reached the ocean. And his followers were so appreciative that he had led them to what they came to do to get salt, that they knelt on the sand and called him Manja, Masagoni Muila. In other words, Manja being the king, you are truly a great leader. And that's the etymology of the word Masakoi. It means the old master, the revered master. So this family ruled what is now Sierra Leone and Liberia for many, many centuries.
Live from Washington, D.C., this is Straight Talk Africa.
For many, many years, you had a very special relationship with this organization known as the Voice of America.
Yes, I did. I hosted a program called Letter to Liberia.
Uh-huh.
I helped with the French broadcasting.
Mm-hmm.
And I also did a program called Your Healthy Family. I was the principal narrator for that program.
I see. Thank you very, very much. And of course, we look forward to sharing views about Liberia and where Liberia goes from here.
You have practically no problem in getting or finding guests for the Letter to Liberia program.
No, we have no problem. I work with a gentleman very closely by the name of Bob Grant. I guess he's no stranger to Liberia. Bob works for the Voice of America full-time, whereas I only work for them once a week in the afternoon because I'm in school mostly. But by the time I come into the Voice of America, my program is set up. The TV or radio, whatever we were about to do, has been planned, and we, after a short discussion, we go right into studios. My guests are always there, always on time, so I don't have any problems.
Could it be that the man came to really like what appears to be an elevated status, which gave them certain advantages and left the women a little bit behind? Would you say that is the case?
Yes, to a great extent. Well, thank you very much, first of all, Vincent. But to go back to what my learned colleagues have said, I think that started in the colonial day when the Westerners came to Africa. When they left Europe, the women in Europe were not emancipated. We're talking about 200 years ago when the women in the Western society didn't have the freedom to vote. And so they came to Africa, where they brought their customs with them. And according to what I was made to understand, I've read, the women in Africa sometimes had more power than men.
Right.
In many, many societies.
Yes.
We have our traditional schools where the women were in charge, and the men consulted women before they went to war, before they made great decisions. So I don't see where this notion comes from nowadays that women in Africa are subservient.
Live from Washington, D.C., this is Straight Talk Africa.
T-
tell me, why is it
May
that...
I beg to differ?
Yes. Go ahead. Go ahead.
I think the issues are in Liberia. It's just that the court in Sierra Leone is the one who will decide the matter, where the venue will take place. But I think the issues are in Liberia
Which issues are in Liberia? The indictment was on the basis of crimes committed in Sierra Leone.
Yes, but there are some. Most of the issues are in Liberia and in Sierra Leone. But it's the Sierra Leonean court, the special court seated in Freetown, that will have jurisdiction over the matter. But I think a lot of, like you said, the concerns of the Liberian people, a lot of things occurred in Liberia and in Sierra Leone.
That was President Johnson Sirleaf commenting on the fire at her residency yesterday in Monrovia. Now, let me come here to studio with you, Ms. Seton. What do we know about that incident? What is the latest?
Well, first of all, thank you for having me on your show. Well, I don't know much since I live here in the United States, but around noon yesterday, Washington time, I got a call from Liberia, and of course it sounded worse than it is. It said that the mansion is on fire. So of course all Liberians are concerned when we hear our mansion, quote unquote, our executive office is on fire, because that's the heartbeat of Liberia. That's the center of action. And the executive mansion is very well built. In my opinion, it's one of the nicest ones in the world. It has most of the security equipment that one can think of, so it gave me a little bit of concern. I called around and I heard different stories. But while I was speaking with the person on the phone from Liberia, I could hear the fire trucks in the background. And I said to myself, well, thank God we have fire trucks. And that's the first thing we have to thank God for. And the second thing we have to thank God for, that there was water in the trucks, okay? And
thirdly, in the fire trucks.
Yes, because under normal circumstances, there is no running water in Liberia, and it was going to be a problem. So I thank God that those two things were in place. So I was sure then that they were going to bring it under control. The king in Africa was the prime servant, because the true African society was the pure socialist society. The king was the custodian for his people. He was the representative of his people. When there was war, he went ahead of his army. He defended his people. And he was the custodian of the wealth of his people, of the land. It didn't belong to him, but it didn't belong to them. He was the one who dispersed of it. When the settlers came, unfortunately, they did not take time out to get to know the African, to get to know his culture, his tradition, his way of thinking. They wanted to impose their way of life on the African, their religion, their education, and everything. This civil war started maybe 100 years ago, but it did not erupt until lately. And it's the culmination of denial. Okay, the indigenous person was not given certain positions. He didn't have access to certain privileges. And when the coup happened in 1980, it was the first time that the indigenous person on a large scale was given the opportunity to do certain things, to rule the government.
So will it's me. I love you, Liberian girl.